The goal of the first part of the IVF cycle is to mature multiple eggs and then extract them from the ovaries. There are many different medications that are used during this process. What are all of these IVF injections? What do they do in your body? Is one kind any better than another? Stay tuned. IVF injections can be divided into three groups: those that prevent ovulation, those that stimulate the maturation of the eggs, and those that do both. Let's talk about the medications that prevent ovulation first. Why are these medications needed? When the eggs are maturing, the ovaries are producing hormones. These hormones can cause the pituitary gland to release the hormone LH, which triggers release of the eggs. In the early days of IVF, before medications were available to prevent ovulation, about 25% of IVF cycles were canceled because of premature ovulation. If the eggs were released from the ovary before the doctor performed the egg retrieval, then there were no eggs left to remove. This was an expensive and inconvenient problem. The medications that are currently used most often to block premature ovulation are called GnRH antagonists. The brands that are available in the US are called Ganirelix and Cetrotide. These injections are highly effective and work immediately from the very first injection. Antagonists work by blocking the pituitary gland from releasing LH and therefore blocking ovulation. Antagonists are usually started after the fifth or sixth day of the stimulation of the ovaries and continue right up until the day before the last injection. Before the antagonists were available, another group of medications were used to prevent premature ovulation in IVF cycles. These medications are known as GnRH agonists. In the United States, the most commonly used brand is called Lupron. I'll use Lupron as an example, but the same properties are common to all GnRH agonists. Like the antagonists, Lupron also works by blocking the pituitary gland from releasing LH. But before it blocks LH, it actually increases LH release from the ovary. This is known as the flare effect. The flare effect can result in higher hormone release from the pituitary gland for several days before it finally starts blocking LH and the levels get lower. Because of this, women who are using Lupron to prevent premature ovulation must start taking it a few weeks before they start the fertility medications to stimulate the ovaries. These types of IVF cycles take a lot longer than ones that use antagonists and have many more days of injections. In some cases, the extra hormones released from the pituitary during the Lupron flare phase will cause cysts to develop in the ovaries. Those ovarian cysts also produce hormones such as estrogen. If this happens, then it may require women to take Lupron for days or even weeks longer before the fertility injections can be started. Remember earlier I said that some IVF injections stimulate the ovaries and block premature ovulation? Lupron is a medication that can be used in that way. For women who don't respond well to fertility medications alone, some doctors like to use that flare effect that Lupron has in order to help stimulate the ovaries initially, and then, after several days, block the premature ovulation. This is known as the flare protocol. Which types of medications to block ovulation are best? When the antagonists first came out, a few studies found that the pregnancy rates were lower compared to agonists like Lupron. However, since then, a few things have changed. First, doctors got better at learning the optimal way to use fertility medications when using antagonists. Second, most IVF experts are now freezing all of the embryos from an IVF cycle and doing a frozen embryo transfer rather than a fresh transfer. As a result, there is no longer any difference between agonists and antagonists as far as pregnancy rates. Antagonists, however, have proven to be more popular because the stimulation goes faster There are less injections to take, and we don't have that annoying problem of cysts forming in the ovaries. This episode is part of a three-part series on IVF injections. Check out this playlist for all of the episodes. You don't want to miss any episodes, so make sure you subscribe to Infertility TV now. If you are already a subscriber, make sure you tap that little bell to notify you when the next episode is available. It's like having a fertility specialist in your phone.